Temple of QI on Mount Olympus, where four mighty heroes have gathered to confront the forces of ignorance in tonight's show about Greeks and gods. And limbering up in the gymnasium of thought, we have tonight a handsome Adonis in Clive Anderson. A cunning Odysseus, Rich Hall. A legendary demigod, Phil Jupiters. And our Achilles heel, Alan Davis. And as they should be, their buzzers are all greasy. Clive goes... You'll recognise that as the Greek national anthem. Rich goes... Phil goes. And Alan goes. There you are. And now that we're all nicely greased up, here's my first question. You're a wealthy Athenian and you've been invited to sponsor a battleship. How do you get out of it?
Do you need to? Well, out of the ship.
No,
out of the sponsorship.
Out of the sponsorship. Yeah, how do you get out of sponsoring? It's a very expensive business.
Oh, I see.
If you were rich, did you have to... Not if you were rich, because I don't think...
Have you ever funded the Greek Navy?
I have never funded the Greek Navy, not to my knowledge, no, but if history has taught us anything, it's that I should have.
You puzzled yourself there, didn't
yeah.
you?
Yeah.
If you were rich, did you have to give?
That's the point. There wasn't much taxation in Greece, but when it came to things like the great ships, they made the richest Athenian citizens pay for it.
So you got an accountant who'd come around and explain how you could put your money in another rowing boat put it offshore.
Offshore.
Which would be the best way to...
No, well, oddly enough, the great thing about Greece is it was a true democracy in such an extraordinary way. If your property was worth 70 times more than the average wage of a skilled worker, they said, therefore, you have to pay for our navy. To challenge it, all you had to do was find someone you thought was richer, and you would appear together in court. And there was this brilliant system, which was you would offer to swap all your property with the guy you thought was richer.
Right.
And the guy you thought was
Richard... Magsy swapsy with you, Stephen.
Oh, right, so, okay.
So you're telling me that the Greek military tactics were based loosely on swap shop?
Yeah. Multicolored swap off shop us, yeah. Kind of.
Oh.
No, oh. It's quite a clever idea, though, isn't it?
Sponsorship is Greek, then, is it?
Well, not necessarily Greek. I guess probably people had sponsored things before then.
But the ship bit of words...
Oh, the ship...
Yeah. Sponsorship, championship.
That's Germanic.
Premiership, is it?
Yeah.
Just curious.
Yeah.
You're very good on words, I always like to check.
The Germanic shaft, there's this extraordinary thing of how the F became P's, Pfennig became Penny, Pfeffer became Pepper, all the German F's became P's. And it happened in so much so in Arabic that all the P's completely disappeared. There is no P in Arabic at all. They're all F's. So Sharif became Sharif and so on. It's one of the interesting byways. Oh, I use the word interesting, obviously, quite wrongly.
I'm quite interested.
This
is just for me.
Thank you. Just for Alice. Now, the Brothers Grimm that we think of for their fairy tales invented the subject of linguistics, and they traced what was known as the Great Fricative Shift.
Yes.
But this is all the Great Fricative Shift. Anyway, how did we get here?
I don't know. You... So, to summarise, if you were called upon to sponsor a ship and you were a rich person, you had to, unless you could find somebody you nominated as a richer person. You'd
That's
say, well,
right.
He should do it and not me.
And you tested if they were richer than you by offering to swap your fortunes in court. Yeah. Now, imagine you're spending the weekend with your grandmother. Which do you think she would prefer, a Roman orgy or a Greek symposium?
Does this depend on the granny a bit, as to which...
Well, it sort of does, but let's assume your granny is
I think symposium is a fun thing, isn't it?
It's a, so you think it's a symposium
It's a drinking thing, symposium, isn't it, originally?
You're quite right. The word symposium, which is now used often to mean sort of like seminar, isn't it?
Yeah.
People getting together and talking earnestly about intellectual things.
And are you going to say that orgy didn't originally mean anything to do with sex or...
Well, it did mean a dinner party, but...
There was also stuff for kids, you know. In an orgy. I mean, it wasn't all just adults.
No, that's right. There was a...
petting zoo and...
A petting... Anyway, so, yes, the perhaps surprising thing is that a Roman orgy tended not to be a particularly wild sexual feast. It was more about the food. It was more about the extravagance of the display. Even emperors like Caligula, they were more famous for having solid gold food and food like fish that was... was bright blue, so it looked as if it was still in the ocean, and all these kind of really... It was kind of food parties.
In these orgies, did they really do that thing of eating so much, then you sort of brought it up again? And then,
oh, the vomitorium. Yeah. Well, yeah. Of course, vomitorium is not the right word for that, because a vomitorium is actually an exit from a theatre, is it, where you literally the people are vomited out.
Especially if you just sing Mamma Mia.
But the thing we think we know about orgies is, always I expect to get lose 10 points whenever I say anything I think I know on this program. But they ate food and then made themselves sick in order that they could carry on eating, getting the pleasure of eating. Now, did they really do that?
People definitely did that in pubs when I was growing up.
Well, they threw up in order to drink more.
Yeah, go outside, be sick on the pavement.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Shake their heads like that. Go back straight back to the bar.
Wow.
Oh no, yeah, the tactical chunder.
The tactical chunder.
Totally.
Yeah. I feel terrible. I'm going to have to go and have a tactical challenge. Go out, come back 5 minutes. Ah, fine now.
Well, that makes sense.
Makes sense. 12 quid's worth of bitter in the gutter and carry on.
Rich is looking bemused as though what goes on in this country?
No, I've seen it. I believe you. I've tried to do it myself, but it just doesn't work the same.
No. So it really depends, as I was saying, on what your granny is into, but the point is that orgies were not nearly as debauched as symposia. Now, what should you do if you see a Spartan with a smart new hairdo? There is one. It's slightly Boris Johnson, but it's a Spartan.
His colour and cuffs aren't matching.
Not at all. It's a very handily placed scabbard, though.
Well,
see, give them a wide berth. Do they have their hair cut before combat?
I'm going to have to give you all those points. That is exactly right. Yeah. Before the Battle of Thermopylae, the Persians made an enormous mistake, and one of their spies who'd gone to the Spartan camp said, oh, they're all the Ned and Nancy boys. I've just seen them perfuming and doing their hair. We're going to win.
So, you go anywhere tomorrow, then?
Yeah.
Oh, yes, I'm going to battle. Oh, that's who you get.
Yeah,
that's right. Oh, the Persians. Oh, yeah, they're a nasty lot. We should go with...
What they
did... over Thermopylae. Is that... Oh, am I supposed to know? Oh, no, I wouldn't tell anybody.
What the Persians didn't know is that when the Spartans did their hair, it meant they were fighting to the death. They were prepared to die. They were preparing their bodies for mortal combat.
He's going to notice your haircut anyway when you're running with your junk hanging out like that.
What? I've never called junk before, but I...
put on some pants before you go into battle.
You think, some fighting pants.
Yeah.
Your best fighting pants. What else do we know about the Spartans?
They're really good in that film, 300. Very erotic.
Yes.
Camp, actually.
Very camp. Oddly enough, it could have been camper because in the actual historical fact, those 300 Spartans were accompanied by 700 thespians.
Yes. Oh, really?
Yeah.
Let's do the show here!
Half hot man.
Yeah.
Exactly. Lovely boy.
You waste of space, what is you? And all that.
But Dardy dog had a greyhound.
Dardy dog had a greyhound.
Were they all very... These city-states, was it sort of stereotyping? They said, all those Spartans are like that, the Athenians are like that. Were they genuinely run on very different lines?
I think they were run on different lines. I mean, as you know, the Spartans and the Athenians eventually went to war, and sadly for most of us who love classical civilization, it was the Spartans who won, who were the least interested in art and harmony and music and mathematics and logic and politics. They were a warlike race. It's a bit like as if the Klingons beat the Vulcans in the world of Star Trek. Yeah. Yeah, and it's sort of... That is what kind... Yeah, would be. And that's basically what Star Trek is kind of based on.
It's unthinkable, Stephen,
I know. Can you imagine such a thing?
Or the Daleks.
Yeah. Oh. Yeah. A warrior people.
Or Britain beating France or something.
Yes. Do you know... The word laconic?
I don't know, is it from Star Trek? Yes.
Do you know what the word laconic means?
I do.
Yeah.
Kind of means... taking your time?
Yeah, taking your time.
Before you answer?
Being laconic. But I'll tell you the story about when the Peloponnesian War took place and the Athenians were at war with the... They sent a messenger to Sparta and they said, if we beat you, we will not spare your children, we will destroy your civilization, we will kill everybody, we will spare no one. And the Spartans sent back one word reply.
Yeah, bothered.
No. Similar. I hate to disagree with the audience, but it was better. It was simply the first word of the message. If.
If.
Yes. And that was the original laconic reply. That was a Spartan reply. If we beat you, we'll do this, we'll do this. Yeah, if. Well, there you are anyway. If you see a Spartan with a new hairstyle, your best plan is to run away as fast as you can, because according at least to Herodotus, the father of history, the last thing a Spartan soldier did before a fight was to get a new do. So what's the proper thing to wear to the gym?
I...
Oh, please! Oh, no, that's disturbing.
Look at your... Look at your tiny arms!
It's rather weird, isn't it? Oh, dear. Oh, dear, dear, dear.
Well, you're trying to make us...
I remember that day. Yeah. Oh, we had fun that day.
Oh, didn't we?
I like to be left alone at the gym, so... I wear Speedos and brown wingtips.
Right.
Not a stitch.
The point is not a stitch. Yeah. Because gymnos is the Greek for naked. It's a place to be naked. That's what gymnasium means, a naked place.
But now that's Britain's Got Talent.
Yes, because the Olympics, they all ran naked, didn't
yes.
they?
Yeah.
Around
quite hard to be the high hurdle champion, though.
It would be terrible if your tackle was the reason that you didn't get the high jump.
He's doing a lovely jump there, and oh no, his knackers have just caught the ball. Another man let down by his tackle.
What you're looking at there is a kynodesme, which is the sort of pouch in which your penis is held in an upright position and tied in a bow. And yes. occasionally
for
they...
Christmas!
Yes. So you tie it in a bow like that for what reason? For doing sporting activities?
Well, so it didn't get in the way and flap yes. about, I guess. And if your trainer wants to get your attention, he would pull on the string, apparently.
Bizarre idea.
Yes.
But there are other things with the root gymnos or gymnos, meaning naked. There is gymnopedia, yeah. which is the dances performed by naked boys at public festivals. There is, and to gymnologize is to debate whilst naked. And on that bombshell, yes. let's gymnologize! Hey! After you, audience! Yeah. No, I didn't mean it! And there we are, a lot of nudity in Greeks, obviously. So they began as places for the middle classes to train for battle, but they added, as you. Right, oh, look, there they are. That's quite an affectionate form of wrestling, isn't it? Sort of love wrestling. It's rather sweet. But there they are.
Greco-Roman, but mostly Greco.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of that going on, obviously, in Greece.
I presume they're playing a slowy.
But the gymnasiums, as Clive pointed out, also became... they also became places of education, as Clive pointed out. But the two famous ones were the Academy and the Lyceum. The Academy, where Plato taught, and from which we get our word Academy, which is now used all the time.
It's a nightclub in the N1 Centre.
It was named after a Greek hero, Academy. And it was
Lyceum was where the Joe Loss Band played.
It certainly was, as a theatre now, and it's used all the time. In the French, lycée, meaning a school, is from the same root. So it's extraordinary how so many of our common words come from things like that. So a gymnasium was an academy.
In fact, the Odeon was a cinema in ancient Greece.
Yeah, you'd think it should be, shouldn't you? Actually, yes. Do you know what its origin actually is?
Oh, I've no idea.
Anyone in the audience know?
Well, Oscar Deutsch.
Very good. 10 points in the... Oscar Deutsch, who was the founder of the Odeon chain. OD were his initials. Odeon. Very well done, audience. Yeah. Round of applause for that guy. Yeah. Very good. Oscar Deutsch.
What happens in this game if someone in the audience wins?
This has happened.
It has happened before. They take their clothes off and they parade all around here. Yeah. So there we are, very good. So to the ancient Greeks, a gymnasium or gymnasium was a place to get naked, though in practice they'd like to wear a bit of support when working out. Now, name the event in which Baron de Coubertin won his own Olympic medal. Who was Baron de Coubertin?
Was he the one who reinvented the Olympic Games?
Yeah, he's known as the father of the modern Olympic movement. Yeah.
And so he obviously set up one event that he's the only person who did, so that he could win it.
To give him credit, he did it anonymously.
Ah. So that's why he's wearing a false moustache.
How many events can you enter anonymously?
Not too many, I suppose.
Exactly. But,
so it's going to be something when you're hidden. You're
you don't need to be seen.
It's a race between pantomime horses. And he was the back end of one of the winning horses.
It's not as absurd as it sounds. I mean, there were some really odd Olympic events at the beginning.
You're completely hidden?
Well...
Tunnelling.
Yes.
Olympic tunnelling.
You're thinking of physical things, aren't you?
Ah, so
but the Olympic Games was wider than that.
So, essay writing or poem composing?
Poem is the answer.
Ah.
He won the gold medal for poetry.
Excellent. Shut up!
Oh, you think that's weird? All the way up to 1948, there was a gold medal for town planning in the Olympics.
Won by Milton Keynes.
Lost by Milton Keynes, you would imagine. But no, there were all kinds of artistic categories. There was sculpture, music, painting, literature.
Sculpture. And look at him go, the young Greek. The young Greek's mallet is flying.
The oldest ever medal winner was a silver medal winner, aged 73, in the 1948 engravings and etchings event.
And that's fantastic.
He was a Briton called John Copley. In 1900, there was a woman who won possibly the oddest event, a farmer's wife. It was the poodle clipping event. She trimmed 17 poodles in 2 hours.
Yes.
Can you imagine? She got a gold medal for it.
I'm sure she did, 17 in 2 hours. That's impressive even to me.
Yeah, isn't it? But do you know the reason they stopped doing the sculpture and the painting and the poetry and everything else?
It was something to do with the...
Drugs.
Drugs and the sex test.
No, the reason they stopped was because they felt that it rather compromised the idea of amateurism, because it's basically all the artists and things would carry on being artists for the rest of the year, whereas the other Olympians, those who threw javelins, they held down other jobs. Anyway, moving on. Who knows what Olympic gold medals are made of?
Partially.
We've all been on this program. You've got four old stages here. It's a yellowy, isn't it? Yellowy metal.
Surface area, I would suggest. gold. They're made of gold.
Oh, bless you.
Thank you. I think they've got another one in there. I think they might have another one in there. Chocolate.
Oh. How did you know?
Hang on, are you telling me then you put all that effort in training and you win an Olympic gold medal, you take it home, you think, well, I can always melt that down and, you know, there's a pension for me and it's not even
gold. You can still
melt
it down, it's still made of a precious metal.
I know, but if it says gold medal, you
expect... It must be gold.
It's gold in colour. There is a very small amount of gold. It has to be 92.5% at least silver.
Oh, I'm determined to get an Olympic gold medal now, and I'm going to sue them.
They should make the bronze.
They should make the gold.
The last ones made entirely of gold were in 1912. But you think bronze...
should be made out of lead. Because then whoever's third is just...
Why are they so big? If they made them a bit smaller, then
they
can make them out of gold.
Now, they're not actual size, Clive.
No, we're... Have you ever seen them? Like, huge medallions.
But they're not as big as a Dibble Fix It. Oh, yeah. Well, John, you've won the 100 metres. Jewellery.
So they're silver medals?
They're,
really?
They're mostly made of
just
silver,
coloured in
but with a small amount of gold, 6 grams of gold, usually.
Yes.
But imagine that there were 18-carat gold. How much would each one cost?
Ooh, 18 carats now.
6 grams of 18 carat gold.
No, imagine that they weren't still made of gold. The whole thing was made of 18 carat gold.
Well, are we doing it at the current rate or the rate that gold was sold off by the Prime Minister 10 years ago?
Please, not that.
How much? £5,000
each? Yeah, 3,000.
Oh,
not bad, not bad. £3,000. That would be 1.5 million over the course of the competition, which you might think was worthwhile, that it was worthwhile in considering how much they cost.
Yes.
The Olympic Games. 1.5 million is a small proportion of them if you were actually to reward your gold medalist with real gold. Anyway, why would you bite, panelistas, why would you bite a gold coin?
To check it's real.
Yeah, and what would it tell you?
It was.
Oh, well.
Not real.
What would tell you it's not real?
Because if it's gold, you can bite right through it, because it's the same texture as chocolate. That's why they're often confused.
It is, it's malleable. And
gold.
So the point is, real gold should leave a tooth mark or not leave a tooth mark?
Real gold. Yeah.
Real.
It would leave a tooth mark. 22 and above.
No, I mean, a gold coin, like a sovereign, old gold sovereign or a guinea.
It should give. There should be some give in a gold coin.
Ah. Well, you see, oddly enough, I thought that too.
Yeah, if you did, you'd slightly spoil it.
Well, that's true, but that wouldn't matter too much because if it's real gold. But actually, oddly enough, it's the reverse. If it leaves a tooth mark, then it's false. Because gold coins, when they were made, were always a mixture of other metals too, and those other metals hardened it. But fake ones used lead, and they did leave an impress. So you were testing to see that it wasn't lead. So it's if it left a mark, it wasn't gold.
And if you were eating lead, you would die.
You would certainly be ill.
But there's no lead in pencils.
No, you... Very true. Well done.
I've been told that all the gold that exists in the world could be put into this room if it was compressed into a cube.
Well, almost probably. Only 161,000 tons of gold has ever been mined in all human history, it's calculated, and the large proportion of that in the last 50 years. And actually, it wouldn't fill two Olympic-sized swimming pools, the amount of gold that's been mined in the world.
It was Nixon who pulled the gold standard.
Yes, for you, yes.
You just don't know. There's nothing to back the money anymore.
Yeah,
This is why the island of Yap, you know, the island of Yap has the best standard of currency. They're huge. They're just big stones. They look like that. See the QI? They're bigger than that.
Right.
A big stone with a hole in the middle, and you put it on your front yard. Everybody knows how much money you have.
Oh, brilliant.
You can't. It takes like 20 people to mug you.
That's a good
the
system.
Coke machines are 8 stories high. And an Irishman came in. I mean, everything was perfect. You know, if someone else acquired wealth, they had to move the stones to the next front yard. And then this Irish guy came in with counterfeit stones, 20 feet high counterfeit and ruin the economy.
Styrene stones.
Ruin the economy. Yeah.
Where's the island of Yap?
It's in Micronesia.
And how did you test whether it was a real stone or a counterfeit? Did you
bite
you
into
have to
it.
Bite the stone? And if your teeth came out, it was a real stone.
I'd love to see the Bureau de Change at the airport.
Very interesting, anyway. The fact is, counterfeit gold coins were often made with a high lead content, so that if your teeth made a mark in them, it was likely that they were fake. Now, which of you comes closest, do you imagine, to a perfect ideal of a Greek body?
Wow.
Gotta love that ball sack, Phil.
Thanks. I shaved it myself.
I think my helmet's much too small.
Phil.
And that's the thing on my head.
No, actually, seriously, Phil, I want you to show me your helmet. I happen to know Phil has got a helmet that you can show me. Wow, that is fantastic. Do you want to show the camera now? Look at that. He's got a helmet. Tattoo. That is a Greek helmet, isn't it? Can you see that close up, ladies and gentlemen? Rather fine. You've got a Greek helmet tattooed.
Yeah.
And oddly enough, by one of those weird coincidences, the wrist is at the heart of this question, bizarrely. We're talking about the Greek ideal, and we all think of the phrase a Greek god and whatever, but what is a Greek ideal? And well, it seems that it's all based on the wrist. You each gave us your wrist measurements. So we've worked out, according to this apparently official Greek proportion ideal. Now, Phil, you've got a wrist of 8 inches. You've got the longest wrist of anyone. And there is a thing about wrists that I won't go into, but... anyway, yours is an 8-inch wrist.
Say that again?
Yeah. You should have a 28-inch thigh. You've only got a 23-inch thigh. Your thighs are too small.
My thighs are fabulous.
I know they're fabulous. Little too small. Your neck is absolutely perfect. It's 19 inches. Is exactly what it should be, according to an 8-inch. It should be twice the circumference of your wrist. All the rest of you, Rich and Alan and Clive, have got 7-inch wrists. And according to the Greek ideal, you should have a 17-inch bicep as well. Yours is 12 and a half, Alan. Actually, the one closest to a Greek ideal is Clive Anderson.
Oh, thank you. There you are.
Now, though the only one of you with one of your lineaments being perfectly Greek is actually Phil, who has a perfect Greek neck. That's
it. Anyway. I'm not feeling that the reputation of the Greeks has gone down in the course of this.
Well, I think it shows that obviously their ideal, it seems, was rather butcher, rather more
a big,
solid.
Fat old neck, apparently.
maybe. There was a man called Eugene Sando, or Sandov, I don't know how he pronounced it. There he is. He was the first of the famous bodybuilders we had. Obviously, Charles Atlas and Arnold Schwarzenegger and many others.
He had a very nasty accident earlier.
He did.
He had a very nasty accident about 5 seconds after that picture was taken. He was trying to lift that column.
Well, you can see he has got a damn good physique for someone of that period, you know, way before the days of protein whey powders and the anabolic steroids, things they use these days. And he, with a fellow called Monsieur Attila from France, kind of invented the modern bodybuilding cult. And he used to have great displays in London, and as it were, and women were invited to touch him. Yes. And they would have smelling salts on hand because they would faint. They'd never touched people with those sort of muscles before. It had never been seen that someone had such a physique. It was really quite remarkable, considered remarkable in the age, because, you know, it had simply never been witnessed. He had the first one to have a scientific approach towards building muscles. And, as I say, his name was Sandow or Sandov. He had a ripped body. Well, there you are. Excellent. If you measure your wrist size, you can work out what you should look like according to the Grecian ideal used by bodybuilders. Now, what does this formula prove?
Oh, I know this. Yes.
Lots of Greek lettering on it, obviously.
Yeah.
It's an ontological proof, a proof by reason alone of something that reason alone cannot prove.
Proof of God.
Yes, very good. Points. Well done.
I recognize it.
There he is. So, the proof was made by one of the great mathematicians, probably the greatest logician of the 20th century. Died starving himself to death, rather sadly, but he was a great man. Friend of Einstein's. Einstein said he only ever went to work because he enjoyed the walk back from the Institute so much with this man. Marvellous multicoloured hair. Girdle, his name was. He didn't publish this proof because he didn't want people to think he believed in God. He was merely demonstrating how symbolic logic can be used. Funny enough, I was in a film with a group of people who played Einstein and Girdle. Yeah. Lou Jacobi played Girdle. Do you remember that film?
IQ.
IQ, yeah, absolutely. And Girdle was in the movie IQ.
Yeah. Walter Matthau, he told you how to gamble, didn't he? Or was he always gambling, betting on the horses?
Yeah, he was a swine, Walter Gatton. Wonderful, great man. His shoulders up like this, as if he still had a coat hanging. Yeah. He used to hold my hand. I'd be in the makeup thing, and he always had this very long makeup. He said, okay, let go of my hand. Will you let go of my hand? Jesus Christ! He used to tell me horses to bet on, and I'd come back and go, Christ, I lost $50 on the Saratoga or whatever. He said, you bet on that horse? Why? I said, well, you told me to. You idiot! Well, the next time he said, now this horse you've got to bet on. I said, well, last time I was in here. Now this one you bet on. And I said, well, I lost $100 this time. He said, you fool! Strange man. Anyway, terrific.
Why did he starve himself to death? I have a formula right here.
Yeah.
B plus L plus T means that you don't starve to death.
Yay!
Proof of a sandwich.
The really sad reason was because he was slightly loopy. He had paranoid fantasies of being poisoned, and the only person he trusted to taste his food for him was his wife, and his wife for a long period was in hospital, so he didn't eat.
Well, she was in hospital because she was eating all this poison over
the years. Well, maybe. So, yes, Kurt Gödel used modal logic to prove conclusively that God exists, though even he wasn't really convinced by the conclusion. That's human life accounted for, but how could sewage be used to create alien life?
To create alien life?
Yeah.
So sewage from another planet may be arriving here, is that...?
Well, yes, or our sewage.
Our astronauts jettisoned their doings into space.
Yes.
There is an enormous amount of human poop up now in the solar system, orbiting the Earth. In fact, it's a film of human feces on most space junk.
So they just eject it, they don't bring it back with them, like in a plastic bag, like you might with a dog or something.
They may do occasionally, but a lot of it is simply jettisoned. Yeah.
They're just inconsiderate.
And Arthur C. Clarke there had this theory of toilets of the gods, it was an article he wrote, suggested that maybe even our life form, as you might have suggested, was descended from poo from another civilization.
We are descended from poo?
He said that's possible. It's a humbling thought, we may have arisen from dumped sewage.
This is Arthur C. Crapp's opinion, wasn't
it? Yeah. His idea came about when space scientists looked at junk in Earth's orbit and saw much of it was covered in a film of fecal matter attributed to astronauts' sloppy sanitation. You now have space debris lawyers.
Do you?
Yeah. Lawyers who specialise in space junk. Why do you think they'd be needed?
Well, in case someone's junk hits someone else's junk.
Yeah. Basically, you put up a $300 million satellite and even a small amount of junk hits it, it can absolutely destroy it.
Armstrong's number two from 1969.
Well, exactly.
So basically, the reason they keep going up to the Hubble is just to wipe off the land.
I think that may be the case, they're not telling us that. Exactly.
So they spend millions of pounds just to go out there with a squeegee and just. Why don't they leave a bloke up there?
You'd think.
With some wet wipes.
Because he'd be producing more and more rubbish along
You're
the way.
Quite right.
And he taps on your window. Pound.
Yeah.
I didn't ask you to do it, so I'm not giving you any money. People who put the wipers on to try and stop me.
So these are space lawyers, right? They're like ambulance chasers, only they have rockets to take them up there. Is that what you're saying?
No, not really, no.
No.
But there you are, it's an extraordinary thought, isn't it? Reasonably extraordinary. Extraordinary enough, I hope, for our purposes. Yeah, we only call ourselves quite interesting, we don't call ourselves astonishing.
Quite.
Good. So human waste could be the beginning of life on other planets. In fact, Arthur C. Clarke suggested we might all have developed from alien sewage. Anyway, brace yourselves now as we rashly prize open the Pandora's box of general ignorance. So fingers, please, on buttons. You've just seen a meteorite crash down on Earth. Why should you not touch it with your bare hands?
Why, it's a breeze of lightning!
There.
Too hot?
No, not too hot.
Oh, yes, thank you.
Too cold.
Yes, too cold. Oddly enough, even though it's minus 240 to 270 degrees Celsius when it's in space, and even though it heats up going through the atmosphere, it's still inside incredibly cold, and the outside is cold, so you might get frostbite if you handle it for too long.
It's like a baked Alaska or something like that.
Yeah, it's really cold inside and really cold outside.
All those foos up in space, then, they're all frozen solid.
They would be, yes. Mm. Ooh, horrible thought.
Quite a clang.
Yeah, I guess that's... Oh, there they are. Around 50,000 meteorites larger than 20 grams fall from space to Earth every year. 50,000. Quite a lot. But most of them are lost...
At sea.
At sea, because two-thirds of the planet is sea. But more have been found on which continent than any other?
Australia.
No.
Antarctica.
Yay, Antarctica, yes.
Because they're attracted by the cold.
That's a bit tough on the penguins, really.
How many deaths have been recorded by meteorite strikes?
Oh, yeah, that's the penguins.
That's why I always stand up, because it's less of a surface area.
Don't touch that, it's freezing. Oh, that'd be ridiculous.
Three.
None reported. No. A dog was reportedly killed by one in Egypt in 1911, but no human deaths. Boy was hit but not seriously injured in Uganda, 92.
Hit by a meteorite that fell out of space, it's freezing cold and not seriously injured. What are they made of? Just carry on. Oh, killed the dog.
There, that's a backlit meteorite. They've got holes in, as you can see. It's rather splendid.
That poor person's hand is now welded to it by the cold.
I guess it's been allowed to chambre. I guess it has its now equalised its temperature with Earth.
A chambre meteorite. You best serve at room temperature.
Always serve your meteorites.
I think so. I think that's right. Anyway, what happens the instant you get sucked into a vacuum?
You die.
Well.
What? Greased lightning.
You die instantly from asphyxiation.
Oh. Oh, Alan.
A vacuum. If a human being were to be inside a vacuum, they wouldn't. You wouldn't die instantly. I mean, you wouldn't last long, obviously, because there's no air.
But it wouldn't be any worse than being in like Belgium or Watford.
How long would we get then in this vacuum? If
depends how much air you'd breathed in just before you.
I'm now basing an answer on something I saw in a science fiction film. Breathe out. You exhale.
You certainly. You're right. You shouldn't hold your breath.
But having breathed out, are we talking seconds, minutes, hours? Minutes.
Yeah, clearly not hours. You can't survive hours without air. Yeah. Well, gas escaping from your body would make you simultaneously defecate, projectile vomit, and urinate. But without.
Just like an astronaut.
Yes.
But I bet they've done it with small mammals in labs.
I fear they probably have done experiments, and that's how we know. I'm afraid that's how we know. Experiments with animals.
Really?
You can survive with no appreciable long-term problems for a couple of minutes. The first sensation
would
be the
time.
The first sensation will be the moisture of your tongue boiling. The loss of taste may continue for days. They have had accidents involving humans. That's how they know.
So it's like having a very, very strong curry.
If you like.
Tongue boils and then all your innards fall out.
Yeah. Basically, it's a kind of vindaloo. A vacuum loo. Yeah, it's pretty unpleasant. I mean, avoid it if you see one of those things.
Avoid vacuum.
Don't go in.
What an idiot he was.
Bless. Various experiments and accidents have shown that people can actually survive in a vacuum for a couple of minutes at any rate. Which country has weekly news broadcasts in Latin? Juntiae Latinae. Oh,
the Vatican City would surely have that.
Vatican City, eh?
Well, it's going very well,
isn't it?
Do we?
No, we don't.
Channel 5 do them in pig Latin every couple of weeks for a laugh. And our nay, the headlines hey. Udete, the I'm Minister pray.
Yeah. It's a 5-minute Latin news bulletin once a week at 5 to 2 in the afternoon every Friday. Then again on local radio in Helsinki.
Ah, Finland!
Thank you. It's in Finland.
Why do they do that?
Well, there's no...
I thought you were going to say they were broadcasting it into space.
Oh, that's...
one of those things where in case aliens are going, hang on a minute, that sounds familiar. We stopped speaking that years ago, didn't we, when we left that god-awful planet with all the Greeks on it.
This is an educational thing, is it?
No, not particularly. Radio Bremen in Germany also carries 4.5 minutes of news per month in Latin. They're the only two, as far as we know. More people outside Finland understand Latin than understand Finnish. So that's the reason for it. It doesn't really make much sense. There is also a Finnish musician called Jukka Amont who has recorded several albums in Latin, including some Elvis covers. So you can tell me, what is Nunc Hic Aut Numquam?
Are you lonesome tonight?
No. Nunc Hic Aut Numquam.
It's now or never.
Now or never. Cor Lignium.
Jailhouse Rock.
Wooden Heart.
Thank you, Wooden Heart. Very good. And Tenere Me Ama.
Love Me Tender.
Tender. Love Me Tender.
Love Me Tender. There you are, exactly. Isn't that pleasing?
I wasn't demanding that you love me tender, Rick. You can relax.
You can stand down,
Rick. You can be as rough as you like.
Excellent.
You and me are going to have a symposium.
Excellent. For some reason, Finland has a radio station which broadcasts the news in Latin, as does Bremen. Now, what are you most likely to see thrown at the end of a Greek meal?
Plate. They don't throw the plates anymore.
No, they don't, for health and safety reasons. What else?
It used to be, I can't remember where I was on holiday, but there were two restaurants, and one there was plate throwing and one there wasn't.
Camden, that
is. That was the main choice you made of an evening, plate throwing or not plate throwing. You could sit in the quiet one, having a nice quiet meal, and you could, about 10:30, you could hear them kick off with the one that was
good. It must be fantastic for the Greek plate constructing industry, the potteries of Greece. It was fantastic. Get through a new set every night.
They're mainly seconds.
Mm. Yeah, they are. I mean, I think you're probably right.
It's not the best.
No, unfortunately, it tends mostly to be
is rice or something.
Paper. No, it's soft, something soft, yeah. So it can't hurt, you can't be sued.
Women.
Well, oh, I don't know where to begin with that one. Something you can't
not
be sued.
Not the best women, obviously, the second.
Yeah. Bless you. Heaven bless the child.
Oh, women come from miles around to be thrown around in the restaurant.
And even the women were smashed. Now, what are we throwing? Is it like confetti or rice
flowers.
Or stuff like that?
Flowers,
or just
flowers. Very good. Flowers. Yeah. Well done,
oh, I
Phil.
Bet the old Greek men really hate that.
Yeah.
There's a pub near where I live. When Greece won the European Championships, soon afterwards, a blue plaque appeared on the wall, clearly been homemade, but a very nice job. Looked like a proper blue plaque that they have in London when, you know, famous people live there.
Yeah.
And it said, this is to commemorate that in 2004, when Greece won the European Championships, and then there's a Greek name, like Angelos Christakis or something, ran naked down the New North Road. Returning to the traditions of ancient Greece.
I was going to say, that rather completes our circle,
he
doesn't it?
He gymnosed all the way down the New North Road.
I think that's very pleasing. Very, 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 very pleased about that. So, yeah, due to health and safety gone mad, restaurants in Greece now require a licence to throw plates. So nowadays it's more common to see flowers thrown. You don't need a licence, they're cheaper and they make less mess. But now, talking of mess, the scores. But we should do this the Athenian way. We should offer Alan the chance, because I can say that Alan is coming last.
One of my best features.
We'll offer you the chance.
You mean when you're bringing up the rear?
That's very Greek. Who would you like to swap with?
The audience.
That's very good, because the audience are doing rather well, aren't they?
They haven't had any forfeits.
I will allow you to swap if you will tell me what it was that got the audience their 10 points. What was shouted? Of course you do, but does...
Oh, it was the thing about the... Not the mathematician. Oh, I'm going to be really upset tonight. As soon as you tell me, I'm going to be really...
Five, four, three, two, one, zero. The audience will shout it out. 1, 2, 3. Talking of mess, the scores. First place with a gold medal made of 92.5% silver, Clive Anderson with 3 points. In second place with 2 points, Rich Hall. In third place with -5, Phil Jupiters. In fourth place, oh dear, with -47, Alan Davies. Good night from QI and from Phil, Rich, Clive, Alan and me. And finally, there's a story of a Greek and Italian who were having an argument over the age-old question of who had the superior culture. And the Greek said proudly, "We have the Parthenon." And the Italian counters with, "We have the Colosseum." The Greek retorts, "We gave birth to advanced mathematics." "Yes," says the Italian, "but we built the Roman Empire." Finally, the Greek comes up with the clincher. "We invented sex," he says triumphantly. "That's true," the Italian replies, "but we thought of having it with women." Good night.
Our 5 days of mystery are almost over. Laurie's search for the truth comes to a grip.